Welcome, everyone. Welcome to my talk. I'm Fabian Moimatsheim. That's a mouthful, I know. I'm a software engineer at Code Intelligence, which is a Germany-based but also remotely operating IT security startup. And today, I want to talk to you about fuzzing in general and fuzzing with Bazel. And because probably not many of you know what fuzzing is, I'll start out with an introduction to that. So we like to call it fuzz testing to show that it's really part of your testing infrastructure and testing workflow, but it's also just colloquially known as fuzzing. And the general idea is very, very simple and started out in like the 1980s with some Unix tools. You have some code on a test and you have a fuzzer, which is nothing but a program that feeds random inputs to your program, code, library, parser, whatever, and tries to make it crash. And that was founded in the 1980s, and many things crash, but like random inputs don't really exercise any interesting behavior in code. So the modern way of doing fuzzing is slightly different. You take your code on a test, and you build that code with additional instrumentation, compile time, runtime, depending on the language, that brings you some extra smarts that informs the fuzzer about things that are happening in your program, like, have I covered a new code path? Have I seen a new magic value in a comparison? All these things are fed back from the instrumentation to the fuzzer to have it guide the mutations that it applies to the inputs in interesting ways and try to explore very, very deep state in your program. And on top of that, there are bug detectors, which are sometimes also called sanitizers, as in address sanitizer, which you may have heard of. And those just like detect bugs, security issues, vulnerabilities in your code as the fuzzer runs them. And then these are also reported back to the fuzzer and reported as findings to users to fix. And what can fuzzing find? I mean, if you can't find anything, why would you do it? The primary use case for fuzzing is traditionally applied to memory unsafe languages like C and C++, where fuzzing can find all kinds of different memory issues like heap buffer overflows, use of the freeze, stack buffer overflows, like in that example where we have some kind of a pointer and we free it and then afterwards we use it. These things usually tend to be security issues and they should be fixed, and they're very, very difficult to root out of code base if not with the help of some automated tool. But fuzzing extends beyond that, and that's also why we like to call it fuzz testing. It can also help you refute claims about invariants. We've always heard from Brian Peterson that invariants in Bazel tend to not hold as much as we would like them to. And fuzzing is a great way to find special cases, edge cases, things that violate your invariants. Whenever you have a property you can formulate in your test code, it's very easy to hook up the fuzzer to it to give you counterexample to that invariant and help you fix it and uphold it. And because not everybody does C and C++, and not everybody is subject to memory safety issues, fuzzers have evolved to also help you find vulnerabilities that are on a higher logical level. If you have a Java application, you are not worried about use of the freeze, but you're very worried about things like injections into domain-specific languages like SQL, expression languages, log4j, log messages. Like, all of these injections are things where fuzzers are pretty good at, like, detecting that an injection happened and at guiding the program towards making an injection. So you can also find these things given the appropriate bug detectors. And now, just because sort of we should also let numbers speak for themselves, why fuzz? First thing, you don't get false positives. I think that's sort of the biggest advantage or difference between something like fuzzing and some other approaches like static analysis. If the fuzzer finds something, you do get an input that exercises this behavior on your code with a stack trace. So you know that this is an actual bug that affects you and not just something theoretical that may be there, but oftentimes isn't there. And that also makes it easier to debug findings because you have inputs and you can just run them and they do what they claim to do. And you can also just reuse your test code, as I showed before. If you have something that verifies some invariance, you can always just reuse that and very easily turn it into a fuzz test that makes it possible to run this test with like extra smarts and automatically generated inputs. And I should highlight some numbers. So I think the biggest user of fuzzing today is Google. And they use it both internally to, most importantly, secure Chrome, where fuzzing has to date found over 5,000 security issues that have since been fixed. And there are also other efforts that Google has in this area. They launched an open source fuzzing platform for open source libraries, where Google servers crunch every day on fuzzing. I think by now they're like 400 projects roundabout, with like all the important things like curl or JPEG parsers and compression tools. All these libraries are fuzzed, and to date, OSSFuzz has found about 8,000 security issues that have also been fixed, indicating that there are like real issues in these code bases. And now I want to transition over to show you how to actually do fuzz testing with Bazel. And for that, I should sort of explain the fuzzing ecosystem. There are two parts to it. Because fuzzing was important to Google and to OSSFuzz, Stefan Bukur and some other people from the Google New York fuzzing team started working on a rule set for fuzzing that back then was applied to Envoy and could only do C++, but was otherwise like a rule set that provided you with a CC fuzz test rule that does what it claims. It gives you a fuzz test that also works as a test and a fuzzer at the same time. This was great work. And we as a company saw the potential in that and started contributing to it. So for example, we contributed the Java fuzzing support based on our own homegrown Java fuzzer Jazzer. And then we started to build a CLI tool. It's like sort of the Bazel CLI for fuzzing. And it wraps around this rule set. It's completely open source. It's developed by us. And it helps you like do the things that are still difficult. Like for you, it handles running fuzzing runs, managing them, running them locally or remotely, similar to what remote build execution does for Bazel. And it also helps you manage, deduplicate, assess findings, share them with coworkers, like the whole social aspect of actually getting bugs fixed once you've learned about them. So these two things sort of work in combination. And I'll show you some concrete examples. So this is my go-to fuzzing example. It's like very synthetic. This is not real code, but it shows some things about this. So that's a very simple C++ function that has some weird magic precondition checks, like if you pass in some values, it will just do absolutely nothing. So it's not completely trivial to like go through this function. Your fuzzer actually has to guess this fuzzing string in order to make progress. So it shows that random inputs will almost never do anything interesting on this function. And then in the end, there's this pattern of three lines that is just a heap buffer overflow where we allocate one byte and we write 8, and then we crash, hopefully, with the help of a bug detector. So if that's a function that you want to test, then with CIFuzz, assuming you have nothing but a Bazel project, you would just do CIFuzz init once and CIFuzz create, and that would give you like all the instructions you need to set this up, like snippets you can copy into a workspace file and snippets you create or you use to write a build file that then builds this fuzz test stub that it also generates for you. So for example, that's like a bit trimmed down, but that's just one thing. A fuzz test is nothing but a function that takes in an array of binary data supplied by the fuzz tool. And then there is some helpful utility class that allows you to turn this data, that's just binary data, into helpful types that you can then actually feed into your function. So you get something like an integer and another integer and a string, and it's valid UTF-8, and then you can feed that into your explore me function. And that's it. Like, this is a test that just calls a function with appropriate data supplied by the fuzzer. And then if you if you do CIFuzz run on that Bazel target that it helped you create, actually will start fuzzing. Usually that's a process that is CPU intensive and takes a lot of time, but because this example is so simple, it just takes like 3 seconds to go over 200,000 inputs and find the crash. So we found iridescent caribou, which is our sort of deterministic speaking name for this finding. It's a heap buffer overflow in ExploreMe in line 12. And if you want, you can actually use CIFuzz to like get more details about the finding, start debugging it, start sharing it. All of that works. And sort of the superpower, I mean, the superpower of Bazel is remote execution. So the superpower of this tool is remote run, where if you have either a hosted or a SaaS version of our platform, you can actually offload all the CPU-intensive fuzzing work to a remote server. It just builds the thing. It builds the thing in various ways, like schedules the fuzzing runs for you, uploads them, and allows you to run them remotely and share. And if you do that, just some brief overview of what that looked like, you can start the fuzzing run, and then you can monitor its execution. It's a bit like build event servers or build UI for fuzzing. And then if you have findings, you can actually like diagnose them, share them with coworkers, handle them, integrate them with your issue tracking tools and everything. So that does like all the bookkeeping while you're hopefully very productive and fixing security issues. So just to wrap up, the tool is on GitHub. It's fully open source, written in Go, so you're happy to check it out and see whether it fits your needs. We have Bazel C++ support. Bazel Java support is something that we're pretty close to finishing, but haven't fully completed. And since we're a fuzzing company, we don't just build like CLI wrappers, we actually build fuzzers. So our newest achievement is a fuzzer for Node.js called Jezzer.js. And that will also be integrated in this tool pretty soonish. And we're also always looking into ways to sort of make it very easy to debug findings and make you actually able to fix them quickly. So these are the things that come up. So yeah, if you're interested in this, either open source or commercial offerings, come talk to me. Thanks.